All right, so I'm gonna go ahead and get this started. And it's good to be back and to be in touch with you in this way. It's too bad that we can't be together in person, but at least we're able to share some time together and be virtually connected with each other while it remains unsafe for us to be together in person. And I want to jump right back in, and I'll talk a little bit about some of the stuff that's happening in the news, but we're in a lecture series together that allows us to think perhaps in a deeper way about some of the stuff that's relevant to what's happening in the news without dwelling on the details, the day-to-day, the blow-by-blow. And so we're in the middle of a lecture series on rising inequality in the United States. This is actually the fourth lecture. And the main topic for this lecture will be complicating the understanding of inequality by viewing it from a global and historical perspective. Before I do that, I want to refresh your memory a little bit about where we've been and then indicate where we're going. So the topics that we've covered so far, the previous lectures concern why we should focus on inequality in the midst of a pandemic. And I tried to point out to you that the impact of the pandemic, both in terms of health and economically, is very uneven. And in particular, it's really impacting the people in our society who are most vulnerable, who have the least income, who have the least wealth, who are members of historically unequal and oppressed groups. It's hitting them hardest. And we still don't have all the data on race. It's frustrating that the states and the federal government are lagging, but there are some states in which Latinos, Hispanics, are reporting rates of coronavirus 20 times as high as their portion of the population. Some states where they're reporting it double their portion of the population, right? And so just generally speaking, that would be one indication. African Americans in some states, 3 or 4 times as high as their rate of the population. And as I've shown you in the past, if we can use cell phone data to see who is sheltering in place, who's staying home, and who's still out and about and traveling. And there's a huge disparity in terms of income with people who don't have a lot of savings, don't have the capacity to work from home, are reliant on earning income, and typically work in places that don't have great safety standards, don't have great medical leave policies. They're the ones who are going out, presumably, to work. I've also tried to talk with you about inequality in health, wealth, and income before the great pandemic. And I'll just refresh your memory briefly. This diagram is a diagram I think is extremely important. What it shows is what's sometimes called the gradient in income inequality, right? From 1967 and 1977 up until the last decade. And what you see is that we have just become much more unequal in over the last 50 years. The way we tend to think about inequality is comparing ourselves with people who are doing a little bit better than we are. And what we see is that those comparisons were not that distant in the post-war period, the 1960s, the 1970s. They started to grow in the 1980s, and they've become extreme in the intervening years. I'm not going to review most of the rest of the information. I just wanted you to have that general snapshot. The other thing that we've talked about together, or at least we've begun to talk about together, is what the coronavirus pandemic will do to the American and the global economy. And I've got some more data to share with you, but before I do that, I just want to start out by noting that we looked last week together at how integrated the global economy is. That when you look at a Boeing jet, for instance, you see that its components come from all over the world, right? And so that a global pandemic, which takes countries offline in a kind of cascading fashion, right? Things were bad in China, and then they were bad in Europe. Now they're bad in the United States. They're probably going to get bad again in places in Asia at some point soon, right? The result is that we are vulnerable to the fragility of the supply chains and the economy. And I'm about to show you data. Some of it will be review, some of it will be new, to indicate just how substantial, deep, unprecedented the economic impacts of the pandemic are. And so we're now shifting from the health to the to the economic impacts of the pandemic, and beginning to think about what it will do to the American economy in the short term and in the middle term. And we've talked about some of this before. I'll just remind you, this is necessarily speculative. Nobody has a crystal ball, but we can project based on what we're seeing right now. And what we're seeing right now is really unprecedented. And so I showed you this last week, right? That the retail and food services have fallen off a cliff, right? More than twice as bad now as they were in the Great Recession, right? We've never had a situation like this before in which literally the state orders all of these businesses to close. And it's not just that the state is ordering it, even in places where the states are now lifting those orders, people are not coming back. And they recognize that they do so at their own peril. And they're just not willing to risk their lives in order to go shopping for clothing or go to a movie or go bowling, right? And so there's this enormous collapse of the retail economy in the United States, the consumer economy. I'm going to show you some of the job numbers. As you can see, right? Again, we're just in totally unprecedented, off the charts territory here. By the way, this number, it's 22 million, that's a couple weeks old. It's up over 30 million now. Let me show you some of the more recent week by week data. That's a week ago, 26 million people. We're now at 30, right? This again is like nothing we've ever seen before. And so one thing to note is that the unemployment system in the United States is completely overwhelmed by what's happening. And so if we look at the most recent jobs report, the one that came out this morning, right? This is simply the worst job report on history, right? Down over 20 million jobs. This is not the unemployment figure, right? Over 30 million people have filed for unemployment. When we look at this another way, we know for sure 20 million jobs have been eliminated. Some of the people who filed for unemployment may be temporarily laid off. Again, you compare this with the previous recession, were orders of magnitude worse off than we've been really in any period since the Great Depression. The only comparable period really is when soldiers came home from World War II. And even there, we're 10 times as bad as we were at that moment, right? And again, you can see the recessions and what happens in the aftermath of a severe recession. This is the percentage of the population, adults who are employed. In a healthy economy, it should be around 2/3, right? And a recession, sometimes it drops down to around 60% or the high 50s. Right now, we've fallen off a cliff. We're in the territory of around only 50% of the able-bodied adults in the United States actually have jobs at the moment. We can look at this sector by sector, and what you can see is that this is widespread. There was some thinking initially that maybe this would just be in the tourist industries, but it's hitting construction, it's hitting manufacturing, it's hitting retail very hard. It's hitting business and professional services very hard. And if we continue, right here we can see leisure and hospitality, it's the worst of them all, but education and health is down 2.5 million jobs. And that might sound a little counterintuitive in a recession, but I'm sorry, in a pandemic, right? But the issue here is if you are not working in emergency care, if you're a family practice, if you do elective kinds of medicine, you are closed. By law and also just prudence dictates that you do not offer these kinds of services at this moment, right? And of course, leisure and hospitality, hotels across the country are closed, restaurants across the country are closed. And we don't know for sure what the impact of this is going to be, but I think you can rely on the idea that this is going to produce major structural change in our economy. And among the things that's going to happen is that many small businesses are going to be destroyed by this. They do not have the cash reserves. They do not have the flexibility. They do not have the legal or political resources to protect themselves. And so what we're going to see in the short term is a major transition, a consolidation into larger businesses dominating the American economy, and particularly online businesses. One of the economists I was reading about this suggests that we're moving back in the direction of the late 19th century, where Sears Roebuck delivered everything to your door, right? You ordered from a catalog. And of course, Amazon is the Sears Roebuck of the 21st century. And what we are required to do right now is stay at home, to not shop, right? By the way, again, doing the research for this, I discovered that the United States has literally 20 times the retail square footage per person as Germany, right? So we have too much shopping malls and sprawls, but what we're going to see is not just the shopping malls collapse, but the businesses that you rely on in Main Street in tens of thousands of towns all over the country, right? And what we know is that the Amazons of the world do not treat their workers in the same way that mom-and-pa shops do, right? And mom-and-pa shops are not always the greatest place to work, but they're typically more decent in the way they treat their workers, and they typically treat them as employees. Amazon and other gig economy employers often treat their workers as contractors, as flexible employees. And again, this is going to create an imbalance in the economy. One of the questions that a lot of people are wondering about is, look, the economy is tanking. We can see it in all this data, but the stock market seems to be doing all right, right? It actually had its best month in 20 years in April. You know, why is that? Well, I think part of the reason is because people who are long-term investors recognize that the high capitalization companies, which tend to dominate the stock market, are actually going to come out of this perhaps better. There's going to be less competition from small business, but not only that, their labor costs are going to come down because we have 30 plus million people unemployed who are going to be looking for work. And so wages are going to come down. All of that to say, I think we can anticipate that what's happening with the economy right now is not going to get better in the short term. There's some possibility, I'll get into these scenarios, some possibility that we might start to recover by the end of this year, right? 6 months from now. But I don't think that the jobs are going to come back, right? The economy might come back, but not all of these jobs are going to come back. And so wages are going to go down, especially for the people at the bottom of the pecking order. And so we can anticipate that inequality is going to get worse. And I want to show you again some more of the data. So this is unemployment for April. This is a different way of measuring the same data. It's up over 14, very close to 15%. And if we included people who were absent from work but not officially unemployed, it would be up at 20%, right off the diagram. And one of the economists who wrote about this said, our economic data system is a sports car speedometer that's designed to measure small changes in speed. What we've done right now is the equivalent of hitting the emergency brake on the freeway. And so our data have not really caught up with how bad this is yet. I suspect, as most economists do, that this is actually much worse than what the data is showing us. Again, shifting to the global perspective here for a minute, one way to trace this is to look at the price of oil, which is the lubricant of the global economy. And what we see is that the price of oil has come down to a price that's really lower than it's been for 15 years. So you may remember there was a little period last month where it actually went negative because the oversupply was so high that suppliers were paying to take the supply off their hands because they could no longer store it, right? So worse than it was in the Great Recession, a sign that not only the American but the global economy is in trouble. We can see this in particular in China, in the second largest economy in the world. This data is a little old, but what you can see is that in February, new car sales fell by 86% in China, right? Again, a crater just falling off a cliff. And that for really the first time in over 20 years, industrial production fell in China. And it didn't fall by a little bit. It fell by nearly 15%. So the second largest economy in the world is suffering deep problems. The Europeans are suffering deep problems. I think there's no doubt that we are in the grips of a global recession. The question is not whether we are, but how long it will last. Now, shifting back to inequality and the United States in particular, and I want to start talking about what we do to combat poverty in the United States. So those who are most desperately poor, and here we're talking about a family of four trying to survive on $20,000 a year or less. And what this data shows, and I know this is a little complicated, but what it shows is the difference between 1996 and 2011. And poverty in the United States went up substantially over this period. This is the period in which inequality grew, right? But that's looking only at pre-tax income, right? If we begin to factor in the earned income tax credit, food stamps, and rent subsidies, what we see is that what you might call poor support or poor relief, government programs, federal government programs administered by the states to alleviate poverty, do that. And so they took a substantial bite out of the increase in poverty, reducing it to only 0.5% instead of 0.26%. If we look at the people who are in poverty for 3 months instead of just 1 month, again, it increased, but not nearly as much once we take into account what government support does to reduce the bite of poverty. And you may have seen the data that came out a couple days ago on children who are suffering food insecurity in the aftermath of the coronavirus. And these are kids who were getting meals through their schools, who are now not in school and not getting those meals, whose parents have been suddenly rendered unemployed, many of whom have little or no savings. And what we found is that 23% of the children in the United States are food insecure after the coronavirus outbreak. To my mind, that's just a stunning figure, right? That's a basically one in four kids doesn't know if they're going to have enough to eat day to day. And when we look at it in terms of caloric intake, how much food are kids getting? 17% of the children in the United States are not getting the number of calories that is appropriate to their age and their growth rate, right? And so I do think we need to be clear about who is impacted by increases in poverty. And unfortunately, the largest incidence of poverty is in families with children, and the people who are most impacted by poverty are children. We know that a few months of inadequate food can permanently stunt the physical growth of a child, and that it also leaves emotional and psychological scars that are not just psychological, but also rooted in their biology, epigenetics. I'm not going to go into the technical details, but in a sense, the hunch that we have that it's not good for children to go hungry has been strongly reaffirmed by contemporary science, especially developmental psychology. So again, I want to put this in a context here for a moment. Ronald Reagan, when he was running for president in 1980, made a famous quip. He was very gifted at these quips. He said, "The Democrats declared war on poverty, and poverty won." And what I want to point out to you is, in a sense, if you just looked at cash income, maybe that was true. In 1964, about 20% of Americans fell below the federal poverty level. In 2013, it was down to 15%. So that's actually some improvement, right? But if you then look at what all the welfare programs that were put in place as part of the Great Society did, it reduced poverty to around 5%, so around a quarter of what it was in 1964. All this to say, the system of welfare and poor support, the system for alleviating poverty that we have in the United States works. It doesn't work well enough. It's not completely successful, and we might want to improve it, but we shouldn't neglect the way in which it is diminishing misery. And my concern, and I think anybody who studies welfare policy is concerned about this, is that, again, we're in uncharted territory. We're seeing more people file for unemployment in a week than we've seen at any point in American history since the Great Depression. These programs are not built to sustain this level of impoverishment, right? And we know the stories, people waiting 4 or 6 weeks to get unemployment benefits, right? Just the basic forms of support. The office is completely overwhelmed, their phones off the hook or busy all the time. There are clear signs that the system is being overwhelmed. So the next thing that I want to talk about is what is going to happen to the poverty rate in the United States. And again, this chart goes all the way back to the beginning of the Great Society programs in the 1960s. And then it comes forward. And as you can see, each time there's a recession, the poverty rate goes up and then it comes down. We've been hovering around the 15% line during our recessions, coming down closer to 10% during our recoveries. But if unemployment reaches 10%, right? Immediately, poverty shoots up from around 12% to around 15%. But look, we already know that unemployment is at least 20%. And so poverty is going to jump up again to closer to 17%. And I've already said to you that the unemployment rate is underestimated right now. And it seems to me entirely feasible that it could go up to 25% or 30%. And then we're talking about rates of poverty in the United States that we really have not seen since the Great Depression. And this overwhelms our poor support system. How does this fall in terms of different groups? Here we can see all Americans. Here we can see children, and note that children have a higher incidence of poverty than do all Americans. That has to do with the fact that it's families with children who tend to be impoverished. White Americans have much lower rates of poverty. And as you can see, right now it was estimated that white American poverty rate was about 8%. It could come up to about 10% if we go up to 30% unemployment, whereas Blacks and Latinos, the poverty rate was already more than double that for white Americans. And it could go up as high as essentially a quarter of all Black and Latinos being in poverty if we have extreme unemployment as a result of the recession the pandemic is causing. Now let's talk about the economic scenarios here. And the way economists talk about this is in terms of three different possible economic scenarios. They call, right, this is where we were before the pandemic hit, right? And as the pandemic hit, please note, this is not representing actual data. This is representing scenarios. So this is not reporting. This is projecting. And what you see is the optimistic scenario is that we would be driven down somewhat sharply by the pandemic recession for a month or two, and then we would start to roar back. And eventually we would get all the way back pretty much to where we had been. This is called the V scenario, right? Because this is sharp down and sharp back up. As opposed to that, the other two scenarios are called the U scenario and the L scenario. So the U scenario is kind of a cursive U, right? You go down further and then gradually you come back up, but not all the way to where you were going to be. And the L scenario is you go down steeply and then it takes a very long time and the economy never fully recovers the growth that it lost. And again, nobody can tell you for sure what's going to happen in the economy, but we can make intelligent guesses based on what we're seeing right now. And I would suggest to you, in a sense, we are already seeing the economy go down too steeply, too fast for it to be the V scenario, for the economy just to bounce back. So the question is, are we going to have the U scenario or the L scenario? Is it going to come back more rapidly and more completely, or is it going to go down further and stay down further? And I would suggest to you that the policy that we pursue right now is going to be determinative of that. And what's going to matter more, frankly, is not economic policy, though that does matter, so much as the policy we use to fight the pandemic. So let me show you some data from the last major pandemic, which is, of course, the so-called Spanish flu of the early 20th century, 1918, 1919, 1920. And what this diagram shows, and I think it's extremely important to see, the cities in green took aggressive action early. And what you see On the bottom axis is the mortality rate. And so as you can see, the cities that did not take aggressive action seriously early, and by the way, that's not the only thing that determines the fatality or mortality rate. Obviously, other factors are important as well, things like the density of the housing and how much of the population relies on public transportation. But generally speaking, the cities that took action early and aggressively had fewer deaths than the cities that didn't. But note the other side of the diagram shows how they did economically in the same period, right? And what you see is that the cities that took aggressive early action did better economically than the cities that were slow and lax in responding to the virus. The flu virus. And the reason is because in order for a modern consumer economy to function, really for any economy to function, people have to trust that it's safe to go to work, that it's safe to go shopping. And the cities that took early action rapidly and aggressively restored confidence more quickly. Now, obviously, we don't live in 1918 anymore. And in the intervening 100 years, the idea that Los Angeles and Portland could have one policy and it could make a difference for them, and that Boston and Nashville could have other policies and it would make a very big difference for them, depended on the fact that in 1918, it was pretty hard to get from New Orleans to Portland, right? And so what Portland did stayed in Portland, what New Orleans did stayed in New Orleans. We live in a much more integrated mobile economy. And so in 2020, if we don't have successful national policy, we're not going to be able to dodge the worst possible, both economic and human impacts of the coronavirus. And so what this chart shows is basically that the length of the economic effect is probably going to be the same whether we take highly aggressive measures to suppress the virus or more modest measures to merely contain it as it pops up. Please note that at the time that this diagram was prepared, which was in April, so, you know, a few weeks ago, people thought that we might be able to get the deaths down to 10 to 50,000. That's simply not the case. We know that more than 70,000 people have died already. Now, this uses a metric for calculating what a life is worth, and I'm always skeptical of this effort in cost benefits analysis to translate a human life into an economic value. But having said that, we can look at the economic cost of deaths, right? If workers die, they don't have wages. If workers die, they don't shop and consume anymore. If workers die, families have to bury them, etc. Right? And so we estimate that the economic impact of the deaths, and what we see is that it is clearly better, not only in terms of its health and humanitarian impact, but also in terms of its economic impact, to be as aggressive as possible in trying to keep the disease from spreading. And having said that, let me jump ahead here for a moment, point out to you, well, actually, why don't I stop there and take some questions? But I would point out to you that at present, we are not being as aggressive as we could. All right, so I'm gonna go ahead and unmute you. And so please note that now anything you say will reverberate through the group. So if we can try to keep the background noise down, that would be great. But I do wanna hear your questions. Go ahead. Who has a question or a comment for me at this point?
Well, okay, sweetheart. Thank you so much for returning my phone call.
Oh, Susan, I think I can hear you in the background talking on the phone.
I have a question.
Who is this?
That's Ann Friedman.
Ann.
Hi, Ann.
Yeah, I have a question.
Please.
You're talking about nationally, the whole problem is at national level, but doesn't it depend on the states? Some of the states are better off. They have less economic advantage. They have less poor people living. So shouldn't the aid be according to states, not according to the national average?
Well, let me try to disentangle a couple things for you, Anne. You're absolutely right that different states have been impacted to different or varying degrees by the pandemic. Obviously, New York State, and in particular New York City, more or less where we are right now, has been severely impacted. It's not just the national, it's the global epicenter for the pandemic. More people have died in New York City than any place else on the globe, right? And so, yes, if we're talking about the distribution of medical resources, you know, ventilators, personal protective gear, absolutely, it has to go where the most urgent need is. That's simple triage logic, right? But having said that, I don't think we should anticipate that it's not going to spread elsewhere, right? And I think, frankly, there's a kind of geographic complacency that's affecting the United States right now. I wasn't going to show you this now, but let me go ahead and show you this, right?
Yeah, but I was talking more economically rather
right.
than, yeah.
Okay, and that's helpful. And
economic to large urban areas.
And so let me finish the thought and then I'll come back to that point. And I just want to point out to you, right? This is a comparison between three of the countries that have been worst hit by the pandemic. And what you can see is that Italy and Spain have really succeeded in turning the corner on the pandemic, that the United States really hasn't. And especially if you subtract New York City from the United States, the virus is actually increasing by 2 to 4% a day, which, as you know, puts us in a chart of compounding growth rate of the spread of the virus. So one of the things I wanted to emphasize is we shouldn't think that the places that have been hit worse by the virus are the only places that the virus is going to devastate. But now let's talk about principles of equity in distributing aid. Right? And what we know is that we have a national economy. And so we've got to look at where economic activity takes place and direct our aid to try to restore growth in those places that are most important for our economy. But what we also should be doing, you know, is trying to be intelligent about our policy. Which businesses are most vulnerable? Those are the ones that should get our assistance. Which workers are most badly affected? Those should be the people getting our workers. And there's a program in place, the Payroll Protection Plan, PPP, being administered by the Small Business Administration and banks. And what we've seen is real unevenness in access to the payroll protection plan. The basic idea is that this is a loan from the government for 2.5 times the value of your monthly payroll. It's supposed to be targeted to small businesses. If small businesses use 75% of those funds to pay their workers, then the loan turns into a grant and they don't have to pay it back. And what we've seen absolutely is that the grants have gone more to small states than to big states, more to red states than to blue states, more to big businesses than to small businesses. We don't exactly know why yet, whether this is just a design flaw in the way in which the program was administered, a problem with the banks and having preferential treatment for some of their bigger customers, or there's some politicking going on with states that are favored by the current administration getting more rapid access to this money. It may take a while to figure out exactly why this happened, but I think you're absolutely right, Anne, if you're suggesting that the money really needs to be targeted to the areas that most need economic assistance, whether we're talking about sectors of the economy, businesses, or states. I don't think that's a partisan perspective, right? That's economics 101. You give the aid to where it's most needed, not to mention a basic principle of distributive justice.
I have a question, Dr. Peritz.
Please, go ahead. That's Harriet, right?
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead.
We all know what has been the ramifications, what this virus has caused. However, when we go to the depressions and the recessions, what were the major reasons for there? What causes the depression or the recession? It's not a natural thing like the virus.
Right, and so yes, what causes a depression or a recession is often what we might call a market imperfection. Right, and obviously I'm underestimating when I call it an imperfection, but if we take the Great Recession of 2008, there was a major asset bubble in the housing market, right? Houses were valued at a much higher rate in this country than they should have been.
Yes.
Speculative purchasing. And the houses were, the way the mortgage market worked, allowed the mortgages to be sold, chopped up and sold all over the country. By the way, we should be very worried that something like this is happening now. And I shouldn't just say all over the country, all over the world. Banks no longer own mortgages. We, to the extent that we have mutual funds and portfolios, own mortgages, right? And investors all over the world own little pieces of mortgages. If we start to see, as we are seeing, people not being able to pay their rent, then landlords are gonna have trouble paying their mortgages. Then banks are gonna have trouble paying the investors who bought the mortgage or pieces of the mortgage from them, and that can have ripple effects across the economy. So yes, recessions and depressions tend to be caused by economic events, but they also are caused by wars. They're also caused by natural disasters, by a volcano eruption, an earthquake, a famine caused by a drought, right? So it is not unusual for an economic downturn to be caused by a natural event. But what I think we're seeing, and I just want to be as clear as possible about this, is that the coronavirus is exposing underlying fragilities in the American and the global economy. And so let me give you two examples. One of them is that at roughly 15% of the publicly traded corporations in the United States today have more debt than their annual income, right? And so when their sales start to go down, they were already underwater. They're in trouble, and that's 15% of publicly traded companies. That's a huge economic problem. The other big problem here is that supply chain problem, right? We are so dependent on goods getting all from all over the world to the one place they're being assembled just in time, right? And that has allowed us to be incredibly efficient and companies to be incredibly profitable, to bring their wage costs way down over the last 30 years. But it also is a very fragile web of dispersed and long supply chains that it relies on. And so yes, we are seeing a natural disaster, a pandemic, cause a major economic downturn because there were fragilities in the underlying economy that are being exposed by this downturn. All right, anybody else have a
question? Who are you talking to?
Well, Lois, go ahead. I can see Lois is trying to ask a question. Go ahead, Lois.
I'm trying to ask you if you look at the age group, can you project what this is doing? Like, will the birth rate be lower, and will that affect people in the labor force? What are the kind of the projections that are related to age? And if you take older people, I mean, if you take people that like us living here, we're that small percentage of high income people, in spite of what anybody will think here. What is going on? Are more older people going to have pensions and they're going to live better? And what do you see for the future happening?
All right. I'm muting everyone for a second because there was a lot of background noise, but I've got Lois's question. We don't have all the data right now, but let me speak to the two groups that you're talking about. First, new childbirths. And what I can tell you is, right, we had a major recession in 2007, 2008, 2009. I teach at a college that depends for its revenue on people who are 18 to 22 years old coming to college, right? And what we know, what we're anticipating, is around 5 years from now, when the people who would have been born in 2007, 2008 would be old enough to start going to college, we're anticipating that there's going to be a major gap in that demographic. So generally speaking, yes, recessions suppress childbirth. You get a baby trough, often followed by a baby boom, right? So people don't necessarily not have children, but they put off the time at which they're going to have children. And so there are these uneven waves in demographics produced by economic recessions. In terms of people who are older, and I showed you some data on this, I think 2 weeks ago, the group that has seen, in terms of demographics, the largest increase in their wealth is people in America who are 65 years and older. And a lot of that has to do with the fact that they were the beneficiaries of a climate in which it was possible to buy homes for many middle to lower middle class Americans. And that for most Americans, buying a home is their chief form of wealth and savings, right? And so if you're fortunate, and I agree with you, Lois, that most of you here probably are fortunate. It's not inexpensive to live the way that you live. Will probably, I hope, be able to ride this out and be all right. And note that so far the stock market has not cratered the way the economy has cratered. And so if your assets are invested that way, you're okay. But note also that many Americans who are 65, 75 years or older are much more dependent on Social Security. And I do think we need to be quite worried about them. And there is some reporting that the inadequacies, the frayed nature of our retirement support system are being exposed. So again, underlying fragility in the economy, fragility in the way that this country protects its children from hungers, its elders, exposed pandemic. Does anybody else?
I'd like to just say one thing.
Go ahead, Howard.
Actually, I look at this whole thing as an orchestra. I think that the orchestra is going without a conductor. And I don't think that we're really going, that we're talking about states. Every state is its own. In an orchestra, the violin is playing when it wants to play, the drum beat plays when it wants to drum, and there's no one conducting this damn orchestra. And I don't see it happening until we get a conductor.
Yeah, nice metaphor, Howard. Thank you. And what I would say is, you know, when we look at this diagram that I'm sharing with you, Italy and Spain have managed to really bring the rate of transmission way down, right? The United States, unfortunately, outside of New York, where maybe you've got, Cuomo, a strong violin, the rest of the country, not so strong. We need, as I've tried to emphasize in a couple different ways, a coordinated national response. We're not in 1918. If Seattle does a good job, and New Orleans does a crummy job, and people from New Orleans get tired of getting sick, it's really easy for them to get to Seattle, right? They can be there in 4 hours. And so we do have to be worried that in the absence of concerted national policy, we are in trouble. And I would point out to you, it's worse than that. It's not just that we're uncoordinated. Frankly, I think we are misled by much that comes out of Washington right now. We've seen in the last few days that President Trump is suggesting that we have weathered the storm and it's time to begin to reopen the economy. I think most public health officials believe that it would be a terrible miscalculation to reopen the economy now. It's premature. The virus is still spreading. If we don't do something about it, if we don't continue to shelter in place, to isolate, to wear masks, to wash hands, to minimize contact, to have no large social gatherings, it's going to continue to pop up and pop up and pop up and spread and spread and spread. I didn't reproduce this for you. It's a fascinating diagram. It shows you how in early March, a bunch of college students went to Tampa, Florida for spring break. And it traces the cell phones of people who were on one beach in one afternoon, right? About 1,000 people. And what you see is those 1,000 people over the next 2 weeks fan out over almost the whole country, right? And that's one way to track the vectors in which the disease spread. So Howard, to your point, if we don't do a good job in Florida, if we don't do a good job in Texas, if we don't do a good job in Michigan, it can very easily spread from one super spreader site all over the country. All right. Anyone else with a question at the moment?
Excuse me. I have a comment.
Go ahead.
I want to say, I'm sorry, Harriet.
Is that it?
I want to say, is there any way that aid can be handed out, let's say from 10 years old below, to take care of the children before we take care of the nation?
Yeah, great comment, Anne. And I hate to say it, but I think the answer to that is no. And so let me be clear. When the schools are open, that is exactly what we do, right? We provide meal assistance in the schools, because that's how we get to children on their own. But you know, you can't deliver the food to the 10-year-old or the 9-year-old or the 6-year-old without delivering it to their parents, right? And so this is fundamental to the design of the war on poverty, to welfare design in general, that if you want to keep children out of poverty, you have to keep families with children out of poverty. I would point out to you that in most impoverished families, adults go hungry before the children go hungry, right? But if there's simply not enough money to purchase enough calories for everyone to eat, over time, everyone goes hungry. And so you've got to lift the whole family to lift the children. Why don't I go on for another 5-10 minutes? We started a little bit late. And then I will pause and take a few more questions. But I've got one more theme I want to talk about today. And that's not just the economic impacts, but the political impacts of the coronavirus. And I want to start by looking at polarization in the United States and in a pandemic. And this is something that we've talked about together before. And I would point out to you that in the early stages, and please note that this data only goes up till March, there was strong polarization in American politics, right? And not just in general, which we know that there is, but with sharp differences in Democrats and Republicans in terms of how concerned about the virus they were. But I think the other thing to note is that in the states that were hardest hit, Washington and New York in those early phases of the disease, Republicans in those states were actually quite concerned about the disease. Not as much as the Democrats, but more concerned. And that does point out that when you're in an area directly impacted by the virus, perhaps partisan differences begin to diminish. And what we've seen since, and note this is now taking us into late March, is a diminishing of polarization. And yes, you can see polarization here with the red dots and the blue dots, right? With, in general, Democrats being more in favor of closing things down than Republicans are. It varies, right? Actually, Democrats and Republicans basically agree about international travel bans. But when it comes to sporting events or schools, avoiding large gatherings, there's some difference, but it's really not very pronounced. Certainly not the kind of polarization that we typically see in American politics. There's more polarization on some of the economic stuff, but again, not as pronounced as we sometimes see. This is a tricky diagram to make out, but this has to do not with the global coronavirus pandemic, but with flu epidemics. And what this shows, and I hope you can make this out, is on the one hand, how intense is the epidemic? How many people are contracting the flu and dying from it? And on the other hand, how large is the city in which they live? And what you see is that actually the flu tends to be more intense and more destructive in smaller towns and cities than in the largest cities in the United States. And the issue here has to do, interestingly, with humidity and the effect that humidity has on the transmission of a virus, and the fact that the smaller cities are located in areas that have humidity that tend to be conducive to viral transmission and therefore are ultimately harder hit. And so I think there's a sense right now, you see it most clearly in Michigan, where you have people from the lower peninsula of Michigan. If you know Michigan's geography, there's the upper peninsula, there's Detroit, and there's the lower peninsula. People in the lower peninsula protesting for the government to reopen, right? Breaking into the state house with armed, with guns. Whereas people in Detroit are suffering and have no desire to reopen the economy, want to do the smart thing. My point is, that's a real indication of both polarization, geographic division, and frankly, an awful distribution of sympathy. If I don't live in the area that's badly affected by it, I don't care. Let me reopen my business, right? But what this shows is that the people who are saying, it's not affecting me, therefore, I want different policies, are being incredibly short-sighted. And it is likely to affect them. And the last thing I want to show you, and this is a little grim, but I'm not going to hide the truth from you, is that if you look at the people who are most likely to suffer fatality from this disease, it's concentrated in people over 70, and especially people over 80. And as it turns out, most Republicans are over 50, right? And highly concentrated, as it turns out, in people who are 60, 70, 80 years old. And so there's a special vulnerability that Republicans have to this disease, at least in terms of their demographics, but also perhaps in terms of their geography in the long term. So I guess the question is, are the signs that polarization is diminishing somewhat indicative of a longer term possibility of things getting a little bit better in American politics? I'm not going to try to show this to you today. Well, let me, yeah, I'll just describe it to you. I think that's easier. There's a really interesting study that shows whether people in areas that voted predominantly for Trump are trying to buy hand sanitizer. And the way you measure this is the frequency of Google searches for hand sanitizer on the web, right? And what you see is that in early to middle March, there's a sharp discrepancy. People who live in areas that didn't vote for Trump, they're trying to get their hands on hand sanitizer. People who live in areas that did vote for Trump, not nearly so much interest in hand sanitizer. But by late March, it levels out, right? Same level of interest, whether you're in an area that voted for Trump or an area that didn't vote for Trump. Why is that? What happened in late March? Well, Fox News started changing its coverage of the coronavirus, stopped diminishing it or marginalizing it or suggesting it was a partisan issue, and started covering it as the pandemic threat to human life that it is. And public opinion became less polarized, or behavior became less dissimilar. And I think, again, there's some signs that things might be a little bit less fractious, divisive, competitive in this country as a result. Now, what's the precedent for this? And how does that help us to predict the future? And I would suggest to you that if we looked at the Great Depression, it had a radical effect on American politics, right? We got the New Deal. We got the Democrats in power for 20 plus years with nearly unassailable majorities, major changes in the structure of government, federal income tax, the Supreme Court, et cetera. If we look at the recession, the Great Recession of 2007, 2008, less transformative for sure, but nevertheless, the Affordable Care Act, the only major redistributive piece of legislation passed in the last 30 years, comes out of that crisis, right? And so it does seem to me that part of what we don't know yet is how long is this going to last? How bad is it going to be? What are the economic consequences of the pandemic going to be? And it's hard to predict what the cultural and political effects of it will be until we know that. But I do think there's a sense in which we may be in a moment where the tide is beginning to turn a little bit culturally and politically as a result of the shared experience of being in the grips of a pandemic. The final thing I want to say to you, I want to talk about symbolic politics here for a moment. And as you know, as we've talked about before, there's been a global wave of populism sweeping democracies for the last 5 or 6 years. It produced Brexit. It's changed politics in Italy and France. And obviously, it gave us Donald Trump. And symbolic politics, populist symbolic politics, I want to suggest, is a way of reacting to increased economic inequality, what we've been talking about, right? But it's a way of acting that's primarily symbolic. I do not believe for a second that the British withdrawing from the European Union, Brexit, is going to bring back manufacturing jobs to Britain or lessen inequality or change the geographic distribution of opportunity in Britain with everything concentrated around London, any more than I believe that building a wall on the southern border of the United States will halt the flow of immigrants, especially given that the number one place that people are immigrating from is Asia, not Latin America. They don't come over the southern border. And I also don't believe even if we could halt the flow of immigration, that that would bring manufacturing jobs back. But withdrawing from the European Union, building a wall on the southern border is a form of symbolic politics. It says, damn it, we're hurting and we're gonna do something about it. Or I feel your pain, I take you seriously, and I'm going to immediately do something visible to address your problems. The problem with symbolic politics is its symbolism. It doesn't actually address the underlying problem. And I would suggest to you that symbolic politics may feel satisfying if the problem you're facing, though devastating, the rise in inequality in this country or in Britain, is not one that immediately threatens the lives of hundreds of thousands of people. But when hundreds of thousands of people are in harm's way and you merely do symbolic things to address the problem, very quickly you lose credibility. And I just wonder whether or not, in a sense, we're in the grips of an era in which right-wing symbolic populism has been very popular. Maybe it's beginning to run its course too, and it's run into something harder, something that can't be adequately distracted from by using the tools of symbolic populism. I'll stop there. That's my final thought, and obviously quite speculative, but maybe there's some chance that politics will change. Now, Stanley raised his hand, and of course,
I have a question.
Stanley first, because he raised his hand, and then I'll get to the everyone else. Go ahead, Stanley.
What's happening to the economy of Italy and Spain now that they're on a downward trend in the number of victims?
All right. So I had a little trouble hearing you, Stanley.
Okay, me too.
But I know you were asking what policies Italy and Spain are adopting. Is that right?
The economies and the politics of Italy and Spain were now on the downward trend.
How are you?
Okay, I got you.
I can get on the phone. The lecture from down.
And so let me answer this in brief. And the truth is, I don't know exactly what policies are being adapted in Italy and Spain. I do know that they are gradually lifting their restrictions. And please note that Italy in particular was incredibly harsh, right? You needed a permit to leave your home in Italy in March, right? If you were out of your home without a permit, you could be ticketed. And the fine was a 1,000 euro fine. It was a big fine, right? And I believe they have begun to lift their really draconian restrictions on movement in Italy. So if that's unfortunately the kind of limits of my knowledge of what's happening in terms of policy in Italy. But what's happening economically, not just in Italy and Spain, but also in China and South Korea, places that have successfully apparently turned the corner on the first wave. And I want to be clear, these diagrams don't show it, but the people who study this suggest that what we're going to see is kind of shark tooth-like diagrams, which is to say it goes up, it goes down, it goes up, it goes down, right? And so they're in a downward phase right now in Italy, Spain, China, et cetera. But what we are also seeing is that economic activity is not rebounding, right? People are changing their behavior in two respects. First, they're not confident that they should be out eating in restaurants, right? Doing things that bring them into close proximity with other people. And this, if you go back to this diagram on the way in which the cities that succeeded in suppressing the pandemic, the flu pandemic of the early 20th century, earlier and better, did better economically. That's because trust is so important to the economy. And you have to trust two things. The first, that it's safe to go about and do economic activity, whether that's going to work or shopping. And in places like Italy, Spain, China, people do not fully trust that the virus is gone. And frankly, they're smart not to, because it doesn't go away. It may be mitigated, but it's not gone. The second thing is that businesses don't like investing in climates of uncertainty. And what the virus has done is produce tremendous economic uncertainty, right? And so for both of those reasons, we're not seeing what I referred to as the V pattern economic recovery. We're seeing the U or the L, even in places that have succeeded in bringing the pandemic under control.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you for the good question, Stanley. Anybody else want to ask a question at this point?
I have a question.
Who is it?
I have a question. Ellen?
Okay, go ahead, Ellen.
Okay. You were talking about manufacturing before. To lessen our dependence on China, is there an incentive, do you think, going forward that other countries, including the United States, will be incentivized to manufacture some of our needs, particularly our pharmaceuticals and other things?
This out. How are you feeling?
Right. So thank you for the good question, and I can answer it. I'm going to point out, for those of you who are hearing me, I am picking up a lot of background noise, and it's probably making it hard for a lot of people to hear. Susan, I think maybe you've got your phone or your microphone on, and so if we can make sure that if you're not talking, that you mute, that would be great. So the question is whether we're going to see a strategic disintegration of the global economy, right? And so let me start with the distinction between a strategic and planned move away from global integration and an unplanned disintegration of the global economy. In a planned integration, what we see with the six-state consortium on the East Coast is that a bunch of governors are getting together and saying that we've got to have personal protective equipment. We've got to have enough masks and ventilators. And so we're going to bring the productive capacity into our states to make sure that we have what we need next time the virus comes back, or as long as we're in the grips of the pandemic, right? And I do think that there's a lot of thinking about this right now, and that frankly, it's the only prudent or savvy thing to do is to make sure that you can get your supplies that you need for your frontline healthcare wherever.
When is it my turn?
Give me a minute to make sure that you have access to them. But the other thing we should be worried about is that Boeing or Apple, iPhones, et cetera, are also going to be disintegrated, right? And that is gonna make a huge difference for the cost of consumer goods in this country, and frankly is going to diminish economic productivity globally if that happens. Whether that will happen, I think it's too early to know, but I certainly think there was already some pressure. Remember that the trade war between China and the United States predates the virus, right? What's happening with the virus, with the president accusing the Chinese of maybe having planned the virus or developed it in a lab or not having done enough to suppress it, is certainly going to make things worse, and that does not create a favorable climate for global trade and cooperation. I know a lot of you have questions. I'm going to unmute, and I'll try to take another couple of questions. We are running long on time. So who wants to ask a question now?
Can I just say thank you?
You are most welcome, and it's certainly a pleasure to be able to see you all and talk with you all. So appreciate it, and my pleasure entirely.
Thank you so much.
My pleasure, really.
Professor?
Yes.
Rabbi, for anybody who wants to do Shabbat services, is on the other Zoom call.
Okay, so it sounds like I've got to wrap up. Why don't I take one more question and then we'll get off the line so we can do Shabbat services. Is that good, Susan?
And then you and I can talk about going forward on another call about continuing.
Call me as soon as we're done. Yep, perfect.
Okay, cool. Okay.
Who wants to ask the last question? Go ahead.
Am I allowed to speak?
Yes, please. Is that Andy? Is that right?
The comment on Howard's metaphor.
Yes.
Action has a principle, like the as a principle, violinist, the cellist, principal, cellist, etc. And then they have a concert master. And second point is Vienna Philharmonic quite often plays without a conductor.
All right.
That's just comments on Howard's metaphor.
Yeah, and so one of the questions, and this is a serious question in public policy, political theory. Are there some things that are better left uncoordinated, right? And in a sense, the argument for a capitalist economy is that an uncoordinated economy is more productive, more responsive, more complex, more diverse, more interesting, and ultimately better at creating wealth than a coordinated economy. A centrally planned economy just can't rival an unplanned economy. So yes, there's certainly some domains of human activity that are better left uncoordinated. The question is whether the response to a global pandemic is one of those domains. And again, I think if you look at the comparative data, and I would note, these are all democratic societies, right? These are not societies, we're not comparing ourselves with an authoritarian society, we're comparing ourselves with democratic societies. Societies that have had more coordinated national efforts so far are doing better than a society that does not have a coordinated national effort. Thank you everybody. For those of you off to Shabbat service, enjoy. And I look forward to talking with you next week. I'm going to end it there. Take care. Continue to be safe. Lots of fun. I look forward to doing it more soon. Bye, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank
you. Shabbat shalom.
All right. Shabbat shalom. Take care. Bye-bye.